Congratulations! You have made it to the very last episode in a long series of Kinetics videos. We started at episode 10, so if you haven't watched 10 through 16, please stop right now, go back and watch them, and then come back and watch this one. This is on catalysts, my favorite subject in the entire world. I love, love, love it. It is amazing, and I cannot wait to tell you all about catalysts, even though we already kind of talked about them a little bit. So, to review, there are four different factors that affect the speed of a reaction. So there's the concentration. We talked about that in episode 10. So if you increase the concentration, you're going to increase the number of particles there, which increase the likelihood of having a collision. Therefore, you increase the rate of your reaction. Number two, the medium or the nature of your reactant. So if you're in something that is a very not viscous liquid, I can't think of that word right now, then you'll easily be able to move through the medium through that liquid to go from one reactant to another. If you're in a very viscous medium or a viscous liquid, then it's going to be super difficult for reactant A and reactant B to actually get to each other in order to have that chemical reaction. So the way that your reactants are actually mixing together and the phase in which they're doing that, that's going to affect the rate of the reaction. Number three, temperature. The temperature is absolutely going to affect the rate of your reaction. If you increase your temperature, that means your average kinetic energy is increased, therefore your velocity of your particles have increased. Therefore, you're going to have more collisions, hopefully at the correct orientation, and that is going to increase the rate of your reaction. The very last one we have, number four, which is why I've separated with a line. Number four is our last one that we're going to be doing right now, and that is going to be on catalysts. So, first things first before we even do that. Which of the following factors that affect the rate of reaction, so the four we just talked about, do so by changing the activation energy? So A, your option A, is that you can increase the temperature of the reaction mixture. B, you can increase the surface area of a reactant. C, increase the concentration of a reactant. Or D, add a catalyst to the reaction mixture. What do you think? Which of the following factors affects the rate of reaction by changing the activation energy? The only one that changes the activation energy is D. And that's why we talk about this at the very, very, very end of these episodes. Notice that I talked about catalysts and their mechanisms. I talked about it again in the energy of kinetics, but I did not start talking about the catalyst in terms of activation energy yet. That's what this episode is for. It is the only one that changes the energy needed in order to go from reactant to product. The concentration, the medium or the surface area, and the temperature do nothing for the activation energy, except for allow for the reactants to get over the activation energy barrier. The catalyst, however, actually changes the activation energy. But before I go into that, let's start here. What is a catalyst? A catalyst is something that speeds up a reaction, but that's really a high school definition. So we want to use the college definition, which is going to be a catalyst provides a different reaction pathway for a reaction. Because of this, that's what allows the catalyst to speed up a reaction. But you wouldn't really use that as a technical definition of a catalyst. I would never have said that a catalyst speeds up a reaction in my defense or my dissertation or anything like that. I had to say a catalyst provides a different reaction pathway for a new chemical reaction to occur. Therefore, the catalyst speeds up the reaction. Okay, so hopefully you kind of see that connection. So a catalyst is a compound or a material that opens up a new reaction pathway or a new mechanism for the reactants to become products. So it's a different route. So most of the time, what I like thinking about is if your reaction is you driving from point A to point B using your car on the back roads, let's say you're using the service roads, you know, you're next to the highway, but you have to go through all the stoplights and it's just taking forever. The catalyst would be allowing you to actually get on the highway and drive from point A to point B in a direct, fast way. Okay, so that's what your catalyst is, something that gives you a different route, a different path, but you're still going from A to B in the exact, not the exact same way, in the exact same overall overall reaction. Your overall chemical reaction is the same, but your pathway is different. All right, so the new pathway actually has a lower transition state energy than the original pathway. So remember before when we were looking at these Arrhenius plots and it was something like this, then it would go over like this, your transition state right here, if that's the one for a non-catalyzed or an uncatalyzed reaction, your catalyzed reaction is going to be lower than that. So it's going to be lower. So that's what's showing how a lower transition state, that's kind of what it looks like. It's going to drop when you're on a catalyst. Now, the new pathway can have the same number of elementary steps. It can have more. It can have fewer steps. It can have a number of steps. Overall, though, it gets from point A to point B faster. Now, here's the thing that we talked about in the last episode, a couple episodes ago. The catalyst is not used up, and it does not appear in the overall reaction. So it is something that is added as a reactant first, and then the reaction proceeds, and then it's regenerated at the very end. Personally, when I think about a catalyst, I kind of think about it like a shuttle, okay? So your catalyst is right here, and it's going to go on this path, okay? It's a nice, round path as a shuttle. And so what it's going to do is start traveling here, and it's going to hit its first stop. That's where it's going to pick up your mom, maybe grandma, who knows, okay? Whee! Grandma has cool hair, I guess. So your catalyst is going to go, and it's going to pick up your family. Think about it as your molecule. It's going to pick up the molecule. Then it's going to take them somewhere. And it's going to have a stop here. They're going to get off. They're going to go to the mall, go shopping, okay? So then they're going to get back on the shuttle and continue on, but now they have shopping bags. So it's a little different. They're not exactly the same. Something has changed, but they're continuing on. Okay, then they get over here and they find a children's hospital and they decide, oh, we're going to kind of drop some stuff off over here and give them to these little kids. So another molecule can then pick up the present. Sorry, I don't know how to do both. There's a present. Okay, so then they give all these gifts away, something that they picked up here, and then they're dropping off here. So on this route right here, they were a little different, right? So they're dropping something off. Then they continue on, and they finally have reached their own home. And so these molecules are actually going to get off. Mom and grandma are now off of the shuttle, very, very happy that they had a lovely drive. And your catalyst now continues and goes back to pick up the next family. All right. And so somewhere in here, step 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5, somewhere in there is going to be a rate determining step. And it's probably just going to be because grandma is taking forever to get back on the shuttle or whatever it is. But that's kind of what a catalyst does, is it starts in one point, it goes all the way around, it comes in the back. So you add it and then it's regenerated and then it reacts with one set of molecules, then another set of molecules, then another one and another one and another one until all of your reactants have been used up. In other words, all of your reactants have been dropped off at home. That kind of makes sense. Okay, brand new products. Now, how does a catalyst actually work? Like I said before, it provides an alternate pathway for the chemical reaction. So if our blue line right here is without a catalyst, so no catalyst, when your catalyst is added to your reaction, your chemical reaction of going from reactant to product is no longer going to use that same pathway. Like I said, we're now on the highway, we're doing a completely different route, we're going to take a different mechanism. And so here in this specific example, our catalyst is this pink line. And so we can say that with our without a catalyst, this was a one-step process and it was extremely slow. But now what we're saying that with a catalyst, we have 1, 2, and 3 steps. And because our activation energy barriers are significantly lower, I mean, look at that. That's your activation energy barrier there compared to the one without a catalyst. I mean, this is almost twice as big. So our mechanism, the three-step mechanism that occurs with the catalyst is going to be significantly faster, even though there's three steps compared to one step. Okay, it has to do with the energy. We are surrounded by catalysts. Okay, you probably are aware of this, but maybe not. Your catalytic converter, if you drive a car, if you've been in a car, your catalytic converter turns some of the carbon monoxide into unburned hydrocarbons in car exhaust into less toxic carbon dioxide. We exhale carbon dioxide. It is no big deal for us to be around carbon dioxide as long as we can be breathing in our oxygen. The problem is carbon monoxide is nicknamed the silent killer. You can't smell it. You can't taste it. You can't see it. If you breathe it in, it's going to kill you. So it's a really big problem. And so catalytic converters were created to convert most of the carbon monoxide and these other VOCs into carbon dioxide. Now, water actually is a catalyst. Most people don't realize this, but water increases the rate of iron reacting with oxygen to form rust. So in the reaction of iron plus oxygen, we can add water as a catalyst because it speeds up the rate of forming rust. Salt water actually increases the rate much, much more. I am super familiar with this because I am from Michigan, and so when it snows, we salt the roads to give us better traction, but also it's to decrease that freezing point, which you should know by now. And so when you do that, though, the salt then gets on your cars, and it has this, like, caked layer, and it looks terrible. Everybody looks, like, absolutely terrible. The cars look terrible. And if you have drive a nice car, which I did not when I was in Michigan, then you would constantly be washing your car every single weekend, getting that salt off your car because water and salt water is a catalyst for forming rust. If you're in bio, if you're pre-med, pre-farm, pre-dental, pre-anything, you need to know that enzymes are your nature's natural catalyst. So in your body, your enzyme is always going to be acting like a catalyst. Well, most of the time acting like a catalyst. And so what they do is they speed up all sorts of biological reactions. That includes respiration. It includes metabolism. So enzymes are around to help your body break down molecules and form new ones. Now, I couldn't resist. I had to show you a picture of the chemistry that you're going to see in your biology books, or maybe have already seen. And so what they usually do is they draw the enzyme out like this, as like a gray blob, and then you have your substrate, which is defined as two red blobs, okay? And so your enzyme and your substrate form a bond. That's what's happening. They form a bond, and then they go through a reaction, then you cleave that bond, you split it in half, and that allows for this piece to break. Your catalyst is still there, so it can react with another substrate, and then this product has now been split into two different pieces. So by having your substrate bind with the enzyme, it allows for your product to snap in half, and then your body can do whatever it is that it needs to do with that. So I personally think that this looks like it, just an adorable little smiley face.
Yay.
Okay, so if you did it right, you will see that enzymes are your natural catalyst. So now, if we were in class in Birdine 106, I would be doing this demonstration for you right now, and I am so devastated and upset that I can't do it for you, but my husband said no, so we can't do it in the guest room, apparently. So this is a common demonstration that happens all the time. I've done it on pretty much every single national television show that I've been on. I'm going to add the clip of when I was on Colbert and did this demonstration because it's huge. It went extremely well, so I'll add that after this. You do not need to watch it at all, but if you want to see a big version of a catalyst in action, you can check it out. So the hydrogen peroxide decomposes into oxygen gas and water. If you have hydrogen peroxide at home, you probably have anywhere between 3% and 6%, and it's probably in like an amber bottle, like a brown bottle. That's because it's UV activated, so if it interacts with sun, it can also decompose. Next time you look at hydrogen peroxide, you'll see there's some little bubbles forming. It's actually going through its decomposition process right then and there, and you can see it. However, that's extremely slow at room temperature. So what I do is I add potassium iodide, which acts as a catalyst, and it speeds up this reaction. So check it out if you want to see something fun. Plus, it's Colbert, and he's cool. So my pen's drifting. Apologize for that. But we're at the very last question, so I'm going to let it slide. So the question is, a diabolical supervillain invents the anti-catalyst, which creates an alternate higher energy pathway for a chemical reaction to take. When he adds his anti-catalyst to the city's reagent supply, what will happen to the speed of the reaction? What do you think? All right, so if this supervillain comes in and adds a catalyst that creates a higher energy pathway, what's going to happen is the reaction is going to slow down. Okay, slow down. So if we're saying that our reaction usually proceeds like this, what's going to happen is we add the anti-catalyst and it's now going to proceed like this. Okay, so it's a huge difference. This actually happens all the time in real life, not the supervillain part. But if you're designing catalysts, you're going to design several different ones and you're going to test it. Some catalysts are going to speed up the reaction pathway, some of them are going to slow it down, and that's how you kind of pick which catalyst is used. For my personal chemistry, palladium was the best option. Platinum would have been a lot better, but it was way more expensive, and so when you're in graduate school, you always look at inexpensive pieces, and so we tried to figure out how to make it work with palladium. So just kind of a little side note. But just to show you a better graph of what this looks like, you're going to go from your reactants to products. From a thermodynamic perspective, you can see this is exothermic because your reactants are higher energy in the products. But then you can see the kinetic aspect, that's your red and blue line. Your red line is your normal activation energy for the reaction. And then when the supervillain comes in, they add the anti-catalyst, which obviously makes this original activation energy barrier much, much larger. So that would slow down the reaction. All right, y'all, that is all I have for you. You have officially made it to the very last slide of the end of the series of the kinetics videos. Thank you so much for hanging out with me. I really appreciate it. And I hope you guys have a fantastic time. Good luck on the exam. Study hard. Go to Zoom. Reach out to us. We are here to help you. You are not alone. We are here for you guys. Have a great week. Take care of yourself and drink what?